In this video, we're going to talk about emotions. So when you take a look at this alien right here, his name is Bob, and Bob is not from around here. Bob is, he's from another planet. Now the question I want you to think about, and when you look at Bob, I want you to think about this question. Does Bob have emotions? What do you think? Does Bob have emotions? And if you said yes, how would you decide? And if you said no, how would you decide? And if you have no idea, well, we'll talk about emotions in this video, so stay tuned. Now, the way I want to kind of talk about emotions, at least initially, and we'll give it a very basic definition here, but the way I want to think about it is an emotion is an increase or decrease in physiological activity that's accompanied by feelings that are a characteristic of an emotion and often accompanied by characteristic behavior or facial expression. Wow, this is a very, very kind of generic and a little convoluted question. If you noticed, I talk about a physiological activity that's accompanied by a feeling, right? And these are characteristics of an emotion, and they're also characterized by a behavior or facial expression. We'll talk about that, because often you'll see people express emotions with their face or in how they act. And we'll also talk about the role of the sympathetic nervous system in emotions and its activation. And that is the most obvious component of an emotional response, is this sympathetic activity during emotional arousal. And then if you remember back when we talked about the parasympathetic nervous system, that's involved with relaxation. So we could talk about those two systems. The sympathetic nervous system activation, again, is tied to that fight or flight emotional response. And remember, the sympathetic nervous system, it stimulates the adrenal glands to release hormones, particularly cortisol. And the parasympathetic nervous system reduces activity and restores energy. So we can think about emotions in terms of the activation and deactivation of the parasympathetic and sympathetic nervous system. Now, the common sense, quote unquote, view of an emotion is there's some kind of eliciting event. So something happens and then you have a feeling and that causes a behavior. William James and Carl Lang, the James Lang theory, they proposed that there was some kind of eliciting event which caused some kind of physiological change and a change in behavior, then that led to a feeling. So again, when they started doing early research, it kind of moved away from that common sense view, right? So they would argue that subjective feelings are caused by the awareness of a physiological change. So this is, they call it interception, and behavior, not the reverse. And William James first proposed that emotions are instinctive responses to important events in the environment. And James also argued that different emotions may have different physiological profiles. And we'll spend more time on the physiological profiles. So, according to James, if you're in the woods and you're walking around and you see a bear, so there's a bear in the woods, so a guy sees a bear in the woods, then the guy's body prepares him to run away from the bear, and then he begins to run. And according to James, the guy's perception of his own physiological change and action is the feeling of fear, right? So according to James, that it's the eliciting event. It's that event, it's the seeing the bear that leads to the emotion. However, critics of the James Lang theory, they said you don't always run from a bear. So now if you've ever been to the zoo, you can see bears there. And the bear is behind a cage. So the bear cannot be eliciting fear because, again, the bear is in a cage. The bear does not cause you to run because you're not afraid of the bear, right? So they'd always say, well, there has to be more to it than just an eliciting event. It can't just be a eliciting event. It also has to be potentially about your cognitive interpretation. So they revised the James Lang theory in 1894. Then they said it's some kind of eliciting event. And then here's the trick. It's that appraisal that you make. So you see a bear and you make an appraisal. If the bear is going to eat you, that's a different emotion. That's a different physiological change and behavior and feeling, as opposed to if the bear is in a cage and it can't even get to you, right? You don't run, you're not afraid. So it's that subjective interpretation of the stimulus that relates to your goals, concerns, and well-being. That appraisal is so important because it's that cognitive interpretation that you make. That's how we kind of think more about emotions these days. Now, there was another theory proposed by Singer and his colleague that talked about physiological changes. And they said that all your physiological changes are similar across all your emotions, and they're not specific enough to differentiate. So you have a physiological change, but there's this generic physiological change across all emotions. So according to this theory, you have a non-specific physiological change occurs, and they would say it's aroused versus not aroused, right? That would cause, again, some kind of physiological change. Then you look for an eliciting event. So you look for a possible event that's causing it. So we have aroused versus not aroused. And if we're aroused physiologically, we might look around our environment for an explanation. Then we make an appraisal and the specific label we give to our feelings and resulting behavior, right? So we have a physiological change. We look in the environment for the eliciting event. Then we give an appraisal. Am I angry? Am I upset? Am I fearful? Right? That results in a feeling. That results in a behavior. So let's talk about a little bit about emotional expression. Now, this is a fascinating topic, right? Now, researchers have looked at the extent to which emotional expression contributes to an emotional experience. And they kind of realized that inducing facial expressions can induce an emotion. For example, their research has shown that a stimulus is more painful when making a sad face. Cartoons are rated more amusing during induced smiling. So again, the facial expression we're making influences our emotional experience. So another interesting research study that has been done was looking at women who've been treated with Botox, and these women are unable to produce the facial expressions of anger. And interestingly enough, because they can't produce the facial expressions of anger, this shows little activation in the amygdala. And then they had these women who got Botox, and they noticed that this little activation in the amygdala, so they had to have a control subject. And these control subjects made the expressed facial expression of anger, right? And actually, interestingly enough, the control group produced much more amygdala activation as opposed to the women who had Botox. Interestingly enough, they've also done some research looking at chewing gum. And they've noticed that chewing gum can impair detecting emotions in pictures. So it's very interesting that the facial feedback we get from our own body, right, that helps us interpret our emotions. Another important topic is mirror neurons. Now, these mirror neurons are involved in a whole host of things, and they really light up when we're observing a specific action. They also respond when we're performing that action. So if we watch someone do it and then we do it, they light up. But interestingly enough, they also light up when we're observing emotions in others. So when we see emotions in others, these mirror neurons light up in our brain's emotional areas. And interestingly enough, they've noticed that the degree of activation is related to a person's score on a measure of empathy. So they've noticed that this correlation here between activation of these mirror neurons and your measure of empathy. And on a side note, autistic children who have delayed mimicry, so they have a hard time mimicking, they also show low empathy. There might be something going on with mirror neurons and the sense of empathy or taking on someone else's perspective. The hypothalamus has primary control over the autonomic nervous system, and it produces it's involved with the production of a wide variety of emotional expressions. The septal stimulation produces a sense of pleasure and arousal, and the amygdala plays a role in fear. Interestingly enough, disgust, that feeling of disgust you might have, is located in the insular cortex and the basal ganglia. So we just talked about the limbic system, and now we can discuss a little bit about the prefrontal cortex, or that decision-making part of our brain. And interestingly enough, damage to this area, and there's a little difference if it happens earlier and later in life, but damage to this area, it really decreases in a person's ability to understand the consequences of risky behavior. The prefrontal cortex also receives a lot of its information from the amygdala, and it really is the final destination for most of the brain's information about an emotion. And this is the destination before an action is taken. And interestingly enough, if you think about damage to this part of the area of the brain, you'll see issues restraining violent urges, you'll see abnormalities associated with depression and schizophrenia. And again, these deficits could be from a variety of causes, including injury, some kind of infection, a tumor, a stroke, or something going wrong in utero, and maybe there's some kind of developmental error, some developmental issue. And, you know, victims that have damage, it's usually in the prefrontal area, which includes the ventromedial cortex and the orbital frontal cortex. And then we can briefly talk about the amygdala. And the amygdala is kind of thought about the fear center of the brain, but it's also involved with anxiety. Interestingly enough, damaging the amygdala leads to more trusting of strangers and less anxiety. Interestingly enough, anxiety reducing drugs actually act on the amygdala. And depending on where the damage to the amygdala occurs, if we're talking the left frontal, then there seems to be more anxiety and sadness about life, because this is kind of responsible for positive emotions. And if you damage the right frontal amygdala, which is responsible for primary negative emotions, you'll see euphoric feelings or behaviors. Even when bad things happen, these people seem unperturbed. Damage to this part will also be associated with recognizing emotions in other people, particularly reading facial expressions and understanding tone of voice. So it's very interesting when you have damage to either left or right amygdala.